Our next lecturer is Dr. Karuna Shekhdar, Assistant Professor of Clinical Radiology, University of Pennsylvania, Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Her topic today is conductive hearing loss.
Hello, everyone. My name is Karuna Shekhdar. I'm a pediatric neuroradiologist working at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. Right at the beginning, I want to thank the organizing committee of ASHNR 2020 meeting and Ilona Schmalfus for this opportunity to speak at this meeting. For the next 20 minutes or so, I will be talking to you on imaging of conductive hearing loss. I have no financial disclosures. And in this short time, I will be able to talk to you about some, not all, but some of the important etiologies of conductive hearing loss and describe their imaging findings. So this is going to be the outline of my talk. And most of my job has been made very easy because of the some of the things discussed in the talks earlier in this session on the external auditory canal and the middle ear. And I will only will be briefly again repeating some of those entities which are pertaining to conductive hearing loss. This repetition is going to be there, and repetition is good because repetition leads to reinforcement of knowledge. So conductive hearing loss results when there is a decrease or disruption of sound transmission from the environment via the external auditory canal, through the tympanic membrane, the ossicular chain, via the oval window into the fluid chambers of the cochlea until it reaches the organ of Corti. So any interruption or interference of the sound transmission till it reaches the hair cells would be qualified as conductive hearing loss. Conductive hearing loss is very common, many times it can be just transient. A majority of these cases when on imaging will have an identifiable structural abnormality. And the classic teaching regarding imaging of conductive hearing loss is that if you do not find an abnormality, you're missing something. So you need to keep looking. You need to know what you're looking at and be familiar with the common conditions and their imaging appearances. So let's begin. Imaging of conductive hearing loss utilizes or relies mostly on a CT imaging. These are mostly done without contrast with thin sections multiple reconstructions, not just in the orthogonal planes, but also in specific oblique planes, which can highlight the anatomy of certain structures, which I'm sure would have been discussed in the prior talks in this session. MRI has a very specific role to play. It is very useful in the detection of primary and recurrent cholesteatomas, especially with the use of diffusion-weighted imaging. MRI is also useful for characterization of mass lesions that can result in conductive hearing loss, and these imaging studies are usually done utilizing contrast. So we will be talking not just about the structures and conditions of the sound transmission of from the external canal, middle ear. We will talk about the labyrinthine windows and some other causes like otosclerosis and trauma, and look at the abnormalities of adjacent structures like the facial nerve and the vascular structures, which can cause conductive hearing loss. In each and every case, it is very important to look at the history, the clinical exam, otoscopy, and audiometry findings, because there can be very specific clues to a particular diagnosis. So starting with the external auditory canal, just have a few images here. First one showing accumulation of cerumen. This is mostly incidental, and it typically causes incomplete opacification, and the bony canal is intact without any erosion. in keratosis obturans, you have near obliteration of the external auditory canal and can also cause expansion and thinning, but no erosion. And clinically, they present with otalgia. Now, in this case, there was a concern whether this was just thinning or erosion. This patient underwent MR and they did not have a cholesteatoma, and this was actually keratosis obturans. Now, there can be bony lesions in the external canal, and if they are usually with a pedunculated with a narrow base, these are osteomas. And it's interesting to note that this patient presented because of a poor fitting Bluetooth earbud. Now, compare that to this case where there is exuberant broad-based bony outgrowths into the canal. And if I didn't give you any history or tell you anything, you would think this was the classic surface ear. But this was a patient actually who had undergone bony reconstruction of the external auditory canals for stenosis on both sides, and used to get several episodes of cerumen impaction, and had these bony growths in the canal. And this was again when he presented, this time with exuberant reactive new bone formation and cerumen accumulation around the bony outgrowths. In a children's hospital, we get several cases of foreign bodies in different orifices of kids. Now, this was a five-year-old, somewhat developmentally delayed, who had this decreased hearing, as the parents noticed, and on imaging was seen to have opacification of his right ear with a soft tissue and a somewhat more distinct medial component, which turned out to be actually a granuloma around a broken tip of a crayon. And in the left had a metallic density, which was thought to be a broken posterior point part of a ballpoint pen. External auditory canal atresias, this is an entity where you can have a spectrum of findings involving the pinna, the external canal, the middle ear cavity, and as well as the oval window. As you can see here in this case with a poorly formed dysmorphic pinna, a complete atresia, small middle ear cavity, ossicular fusion, and this patient also had oval window narrowing, which we'll talk about in a bit. There is this yardstick for grading scale for as a part of the evaluation of patients with the external auditory canal atresia, which looks at specifically at these different entities, and a score is imparted to that. And this scoring system is very useful, not only just for evaluation of patients with external auditory canal atresia, but is actually very applicable to any case of conductive hearing loss or any case of the temporal bone that you're evaluating. So moving on from the external ear to the middle ear causes of conductive hearing loss. Now, the first three causes of fluid infection and inflammation with granulation tissue are by far the most common causes, but many of them don't need imaging. They can be diagnosed clinically, and appropriate management can be done. In certain cases, you may need to do imaging, particularly in some cases of infection when there is question of complications or intracranial extension. So we start with the important entity in this group, that is the cholesteatomas. I'm sure this has been discussed, so we will just briefly touch upon them, starting with the pars flaccida cholesteatomas, which are the most common of the cholesteatomas, and as the name suggests, start from the pars flaccida portion of the cholesteatoma of the tympanic membrane. So these cholesteatomas are found when they start, they are typically lateral to the ossicular chain. And here I have three cases of varying sizes of the pars flaccida cholesteatomas. The first one is a very small one, which is just about starting to encroach into the Prusak space or the lateral epitympanic recess. And notice the scutum is still sharp and pointed. In this case now, there is a little more extension and ulnar effacement of the Prusak space with blunting of the scutum. And in this case, where there is a large soft tissue mass, almost completely opacifying the middle ear cavity and encasing the ossicles with poor visualization. And in these cases, you need to ensure in your checklist and look at whether the sinus tympani is involved, look at the bony covering of the lateral semicircular canal, notice the facial nerve canal and the integrity of the tegment tympani. The next group of cholesteatomas are pars tensa cholesteatomas, and these are usually found lateral to the medial to the ossicular chain, and they arise from the pars tensa portion of the tympanic membrane, and here is one such example. And this third group of cholesteatomas, which are, as the name suggests, congenital, they can occur without the typical history of episodes of otomastoiditis. And the tympanic membrane in these cases is usually normal. Here is an example where you can see the normal translucent tympanic membrane and the pearly white small cholesteatoma. And one of the striking features in this case is that since they have not had repeated episodes of mastoiditis, they have good pneumatization of the mastoid air cells. And in this case, there is aeration of the petrous apex also, which remains clear, and this well-defined soft tissue, which was a congenital cholesteatoma. An important slide, specifically, since this is a SAM review session, in the recent years, diffusion-weighted MR imaging has been increasingly utilized for the detection of cholesteatomas because of the properties of the cholesteatoma, they demonstrate restricted diffusion. And this is a very important distinguishing feature from granulation tissue, which does not restrict and would typically show some enhancement. Cholesteatomas do not show enhancement, and many times they may coexist with a small amount of surrounding granulation tissue, as you can see here in this case, and they will be bright on diffusion and show low signal on the ADC maps. As far as otomastoiditis goes, we are going to be talking in this session only about chronic otomastoiditis. So here you see a sequelae of prior episodes of inflammation, which can involve the ossicular chain, the tympanic membrane, and the muscles and the ligaments of the suspensory ligaments of the ossicular chain, and are accompanied with sclerosis or under-pneumatization of the mastoid air cells. So here, these can be somewhat challenging to diagnose, particularly when at the time of imaging, you do not see the soft tissue or granulation tissue or cholesteatomas on imaging. But the clues can be that some of the structures, which are generally imperceptible, are just seen too well. Like in this case, you can see the distal, long process of the incus and the capitulum of the stapes, and their articulation is just too well seen here. Normally, they are just barely perceptible. And this is the same thing as you can see it on the axial plane, which is due to the focal calcification in these locations of the ossicular chain. And I have to show you this pretty dramatic case of tympanosclerosis or meningosclerosis. I apologize. These are images from an outside facility when this patient came in. And if you notice, the tympanic membranes are just sheets of dense white material due to the extensive deposition of calcium here. And it's interesting to read the anti-surgeon note that he mentioned that it felt like it was a bony plate rather than a thin membrane. And he was actually unable to place meningotomy tubes in this patient. Moving on now to ossicular abnormalities. These can be either isolated or can be in association with other external auditory canal and middle ear abnormalities. Here I have some examples of the fixation of the malleus, which can be either congenital or falling inflammation. This case, that is fixation to the lateral wall of the middle ear cavity and here to the tegmen. Just a word here, when you see these bony bars, it should be noted that that there may be decreased mobility and somewhat impedance to the sound transmission, but it does not mean that sound is not getting transmitted. And also when you notice this, it does not mean that these bony bars are the cause of the conductive hearing loss. They should be mentioned, and the ENT surgeon will then evaluate or look closely for the mobility of these structures, which is better assessed by the ENT surgeons on direct examination. A specific word about the long presses of incus and the abnormalities that may be seen. Just because of the nature of the embryology and the blood supply, this is a part of the bone that is of the ossicular chain, which is very vulnerable to either infection, inflammation, or trauma. And it can be somewhat challenging to be identified, but if it is unilateral, you can make use of the opposite side and compare it to that side and see. So in this case, you can see that the posterior dot of what we identify the long process of the incus is missing on the right side. And you cannot see the long process and the stapes articulations. There seems to be a defect. And the same thing on the coronal plane, you can notice the normal side here. And here you can barely see, or it's a very thin or poorly visualized lenticular and long process of the incus, and a defect at the articulation. I want to draw your attention to this very nice paper and by Dr. Hugh Curtin and colleagues, which mentioned this entity of distal incus long process being replaced by fibrous tissue. And this can be radiologically occult because this will be visualized as a defect on imaging. But on actual direct examination, the fibrous tissue can actually be seen well by the ENT people. So you need to be aware of this condition, and special attention needs to be focused on every case to evaluate the long process of the incus. Moving on, we'll talk about the labyrinthine window, specifically the oval window. So this, I showed you a case of external auditory canal atresia, and in that case itself, there was narrowing or severe narrowing or atresia of the oval window. So when you have a case of atresia, the next thing you immediately need to look at is the course of the facial nerve, because as soon as there is narrowing or atresia, the facial nerve tends to take a shortcut and travel inferiorly and more anteriorly. And in some cases, the canal can be dehiscent, and the unroofed or the uncovered facial nerve can be traversing across the oval window, and the stapes may be directly attached on it. And if there is a surgery planned for the replacement of the stapes, the facial nerve can get inadvertently damaged. So it is very important to highlight this anatomic course of the facial nerve. When there is atresia, it is easy, and your attention is goes to visualization of the oval window. But when there is no atresia, this is a condition which can be easily overlooked. At that time, it is very important to do the comparison of the structures with the normal side. And here you can make out that this is the normal caliber of the oval window fossa, and there is actually a narrowing in this case here. We talked about the aberrant course of the facial nerve associated with atresia or narrowing of the oval window, but there is another condition which can be associated specifically with conductive hearing loss, and those are schwannomas of the facial nerve tympanic segment. I have here an image from the literature, from the paper of Dr. Wiggins et al., and you can see that there is a lobulated mass in the tympanic segment, replacing the snake eyes. This mass is extending into the middle ear cavity and causing displacement of the ossicles and resulting in conductive hearing loss. And mind you, these patients may not present with any facial nerve deficits. So now we move on to some of the other causes, starting with otosclerosis or otospongiosis. In this disorder, there are lytic or spongy plaques which replace the normal bone of the otic capsule. And this process typically starts at a location called the fistula antefenestrum, which is located anterior to the oval window. And it can extend from there and go perifenestral or extend all along the bony labyrinth and be described as cochlear or retrofenestral. So this is an entity which is very uncommon in the pediatric age group. But however, this was a case which we just got about a month ago. And in this case, family history is very important. The dad had history of otosclerosis and already had a stapes replacement surgery. And here in this case, you can see that there is a lytic or a less dense bone which is seen anterior to the oval window at the fistula antefenestrum. And this is not just fenestral. If you notice, there is this lucency around the cochlea, which is also involved. And this was both fenestral and cochlear otosclerosis. If you see this lucency around the cochlea, in these cases of cochlear otosclerosis, there is always a fenestral otosclerosis present. And this is the same case, better visualized in the zoomed out axial and coronal projections, showing this plaque of otosclerosis at the fistula antefenestrum. Trauma can result in conductive hearing loss, and there are many classifications of the trauma of fractures involving the temporal bone, but the most relevant descriptor that you need to put in is whether it involves or it spares the otic capsule. Here is an example which shows a complex sort of a fracture. The dominant fracture line is along the long axis of the temporal bone, and it is actually sparing the otic capsule, but the medial trajectory, you can see there is an associated fracture of the lateral wall of the sphenoid sinus. In the zoomed out view, you can notice that there is a wide gap between the normal ice cream cone relationship of the malleus head and the incus, between the ice cream and the cone. And here is another example of a trauma where this is a fracture perpendicular to the long axis of the temporal bone. And importantly, this is violating the otic capsule. You can see findings of pneumolabyrinth, and also there is injury to the facial nerve canal. Unfortunately, in these cases, when the otic capsule is injured or involved, they result in an irreversible hearing loss. Lastly, some word on the third window phenomenon. Now, the fluid chambers in the inner ear, they are a tight closed hydraulic system. And whenever there is any defect or thinning of this integrity, this does not, it does not remain a closed or a sealed system and can affect the transmission of sound. These patients can present with either a pure conducting or a mixed type of hearing loss. And can have associated symptoms like the auditory of the vestibular symptoms and nystagmus, Tullio's phenomenon, which is vertigo induced by a high pressure or loud sounds can be closely associated with the conditions like superior semicircular canal dehiscence, which is one of the most common causes. And it's not just the superior canal. Sometimes the next most common canal that can be dehiscent is the lateral semicircular canal. Enlarged vestibular aqueduct or dehiscence of the jugular and the carotid vessels can also result in conductive hearing loss due to the similar third window phenomenon. Here we have an example of superior semicircular canal dehiscence. We have taken advantage of these oblique reformations, which show the dehiscent roof compared to this normal intact roof here in this, as shown here. Dehiscence can be of the jugular bulb, and when it is dehiscent, you can see the jugular vein enters into the middle ear cavity, and as you can see here, is blocking the round window niche. And on clinical examination, these present with conductive hearing loss can have symptoms of tinnitus, and on otoscopy, there's usually a blue hue seen in the left lower quadrant of the tympanic membrane. When you see a red mass behind the tympanic membrane, and if there is pulsatile tinnitus, you need to think of two entities. The first one is the aberrant carotid artery. As you can see, it is taking an aberrant course through the middle ear cavity and going along the promontory here to become the horizontal segment or the petrous segment. It encroaches on the inferior aspect of the middle ear cavity. And unfortunately, many of these cases, they get detected accidentally on procedures, meningotomy procedures, when they unexpectedly find gushes of bright blood when they go to place these tubes. And this is the last case that I'm going to show you, which is a case of glomus jugular tympanicum, which will present with conductive hearing loss, pulsatile tinnitus, and a red mass behind the tympanic membrane. This is a case lent to be my good friend Gulmonis, and you can see here there is a soft tissue with a broad base along the cochlear promontory. On further characterization by MRI, you can see that this is an enhancing mass lesion, and when they are large, they can actually have the typical salt and pepper appearance on imaging. So we looked at a number of conditions that could result in conductive hearing loss. These in the middle ear, which are highlighted in the white color, are those where the tympanic membrane is not normal, and the other conditions would be when there would be a dry middle ear cavity. So some take-home points is that in the evaluation of conductive hearing loss, a systematic approach is key. You need to have a very diligent checklist for each and every case that you evaluate. If you see a finding, do not fall prey to the satisfaction of search. There can be more than one finding because multiple abnormalities can be associated in a single case. Look carefully at the clinical history, the otoscopy and audiometry findings. They can be very helpful. Do not forget to evaluate the seventh cranial nerve and comment on it in each and every case, particularly those associated with oval window narrowing and atresia, where there can be an aberrant course of the nerve and the nerve may be dehiscent. Check all the windows and the adjacent structures, the carotid and the jugular vein. And specifically check for some of the more elusive causes of conductive hearing loss, such as the distal long process incus resorption, oval window narrowing or atresia, and third window phenomena in the clinically appropriate cases. And with that, this brings me to my last slide. And I find myself giving this disclaimer repeatedly because it's distressing in the current times. And I remind people that my name is pronounced Karuna and not Corona. And finally, a big shout out and thank you to all the frontline warriors, COVID warriors, and all the COVID warriors in this head and neck fraternity. Thank you very much.
Our next lecturer is Dr. Gulmonis, Associate Professor of Radiology, Columbia University Medical Center, New York, New York. Her topic today is cochlear implantation preoperative workup.
Hello, everybody. Today, I'm going to be discussing a preoperative imaging workup of cochlear implantation patients. This is going to be our outline. First, we'll talk about what a cochlear implant is. Next, we will discuss imaging findings which would impact candidacy for cochlear implantation, prognosis, and the site of surgery. We will have a brief discussion on the surgical steps and then the imaging findings which would impact those surgical steps. So, hearing loss can be divided into two major categories: conductive hearing loss, which is essentially any condition that impedes transmission of sound waves from the external environment through the external auditory canal and the middle ear to the oval window. Sensory neural hearing loss results from congenital or acquired abnormalities of the membranous labyrinth, specifically the hair cells in the organ of Corti, or the cochlear nerve itself. The most common cause for sensory neural hearing loss in adults would be from aging or other factors being noise exposure, medications, infections, etc. So what is a cochlear implant? It's a device which converts sound to electric signal. It bypasses the diseased hair cells of the cochlea and directly stimulates the ganglionic cells of the cochlear nerve. It has an external component comprised of a microphone, sound processor, and transmitter, and an internal component comprised of the cochlear implant magnet, also known as the receiver stimulator complex, and an electrode array which enters the inner ear through the mastoid ear cells and the round window from which it enters the cochlea. The external and internal components are magnetically connected. So the ideal candidate for cochlear implant would be some patient who has profound bilateral sensory neural hearing loss with less than 50% word recognition score while wearing an optimally fit hearing aid. It is also approved for use in children more than 9 months of age. However, in kids, it's important that they be enrolled in an education program emphasizing auditory development, and the patients, families, and parents must be committed to the process of auditory rehabilitation. It can also be performed in patients with vestibular schwannoma who have had gamma knife performed, and this in this setting, cochlear implantation really helps mostly with the tinnitus aspect as opposed to improving hearing. Cochlear implant has been recently approved for single-sided deafness. And again, in this setting, it helps more with the tinnitus than with the actual hearing loss. Is imaging needed? There are multiple papers out in the otologic literature which conclude that you may not need to do imaging in the appropriately selected patient, especially an adult. However, for all intents and purposes, our surgeons get imaging on every patient who gets a cochlear implant, and it is especially useful in children who have cochlear malformations. In terms of modality, you could either do a MDCT or an MRI. You can't really go wrong with either one. In kids, sometimes the surgeon may start off with an MRI to avoid radiation. But ultimately, I feel like both modalities have a complementary role in evaluation preoperatively. So remember, for MRI, it is extremely important to obtain these heavily T2-weighted three-dimensional sequences with cisternographic effect. They can either be gradient echo or Fastman echo T2-weighted images, and they come by different names by different vendors. In terms of relevant cochlear anatomy, just remember that the central bony core of the cochlea is called the modilus, and arising from the modilus, akin to the threads of a screw, are these bony projections called the osseous spiral lamina, which divide the bony labyrinth into scala vestibuli superiorly and scala tympani inferiorly. Now, the osseous spiral lamina also contain the ganglion for the cochlear nerve. On these images, histology, you can nicely see the central modilus, osseous spiral lamina, scala vestibuli, scala tympani, and this middle portion called the scala media. This appearance is well seen on a CT scan as a hourglass structure, which is the modalis on both CT and MRI. The interscalar septa are septations between the scala vestibuli of one turn and the scala tympani of the next turn. And again, seen quite well on both CT and MRI using the cisternographic heavily tituated sequences. So as a general rule, cochlear implantation is done on the worst hearing ear. However, imaging findings can impact site selection, as we will see in this presentation. There's a twofold role of preoperative imaging for cochlear implants. First of all, we want to identify if the patient is actually a candidate for surgery or not, and if they are, which site should be implanted, and what will be the prognosis after surgery. The second major role is to guide the surgeon for the surgical access and surgical approach. So going to the first role, there are three important anatomical pieces of information that the surgeon is looking for. Anatomy of the cochlea. Is the cochlear nerve present or absent? What's the status of the fluid in the scala vestibuli and tympani? I.e., does the patient have labyrinthitis ossificans? In terms of cochlear anatomy, congenital cochlear anomalies are really, what the surgeon needs to know about preoperatively, because it can have an impact on the prognosis of the patient. So this was a nice paper which classified the modalis into seven types, depending on, being most normal to the least normal. And you can see that this is a very nice looking modalis. It goes from the base to the apex. And this is a situation where the modalis and the interscalar septa and the osseous spiral lamina are all absent. The cochlear aperture is widely open and patent. Now, in this situation, this is when patients can develop the so-called CSF gusher phenomenon, in which there's egress of profuse amounts of CSF during the insertion of the cochlear implant or cochleostomy. And that's because the CSF and the perilymph are communicating without any discernible modalis or a pretty wide cochlear aperture. So one of the problems with a CSF gusher situation is that this can injure the membranous labyrinth and lead to postoperative hearing loss, tinnitus, or vestibular dysfunction. And it is something that the surgeon usually wants to be prepared for preoperatively. They can mitigate this during surgery by making a smaller hole in the round window or in the cochlea by sealing that area with muscle around the electrodes, and also to use some specially designed electrodes. So important for them to know if the patient could have cochlear anomalies which might predispose to CSF gushing. So this slide sort of gives you a summary of the status of cochlear implant in cochlear malformations. So in patients with congenital or complete labyrinthine aplasia and cochlear aplasia, cochlear implantation is contraindicated. In patients with common cavity, incomplete partition type 2, cochlear hypoplasia, there is an increased incidence of facial nerve aberrant course and should be sought for on imaging studies so that one can warn our surgeons preoperatively. Pretty much all of these malformations have an increased incidence of CSF gushers. And that's because, as you can see, the cochlear aperture is pretty wide open, especially in incomplete partition type 3. And there is a variable degree of hypoplasia of the bony modalis. And so all of these patients have this sort of slightly increased risk of CSF gushing. In incomplete partition type 2, it tends to be more of an ooze than a gush. But nonetheless, they're all at risk. What about the situation where on high-res CT you see that there is a complete absence of the cochlear aperture on the left side? The right cochlear aperture is completely normal. And this is a separate patient who has bilateral stenosis of the IAC. In this situation, you would recommend getting an MRI to see if the cochlear nerve is present. And in this case, you can see that the cochlear nerve is nicely present on the left side, but is absent on the right side, on both axials and sagittals. So used to be that cochlear nerve deficiency or absent cochlear nerve was an absolute contraindication to cochlear implantation. This is no longer the case, and kids are being implanted with an absent or deficient eighth nerve with some varying results, unpredictable results, maybe poorer than expected compared to kids who have a normal anatomy. But some kids can surprise you and actually do pretty well, even though you don't see a cochlear nerve on MRI. And so remember that audiology trumps MRI. So the MRI may show an absent cochlear nerve, but if the audiology indicates that there's maybe some amount of hearing present, then these patients should not be denied a chance with cochlear implants. Labyrinthitis ossificans is a serious complication of meningitis. And the situation with this with this entity is that the surgeon will try and do surgery as early as possible before the ossification stage has occurred. And so this tends to be a kind of an urgent cochlear implantation. And in kids, the surgeon might even do both sides in the same sitting because they just want to like catch it before it goes into a later either fibrous or ossification stage. Even after ossification with luminal obstruction, it's not really a contraindication for implantation, but it's important for them to know preoperatively so that they can be prepared for a long day at the office, and they can sort of choose special electrode arrays to mitigate this. So this is an example where there's normal fluid signal in the right cochlea and vestibule. And on the left side, there's a little bit of fibrous stage happening. You can see there's loss of fluid signal in both the vestibule and the cochlea. And again, not a contraindication, but something that the surgeon would want to know beforehand. And just to show you that CT lags behind MRI in the evaluation of labyrinthitis ossificans. Cochlear implantation can be performed in patients who have far advanced otosclerosis with the severe profound sensorineural hearing loss. However, the surgeons have to be ready to have a technical challenge because the bone can be quite thick surrounding the cochlea. These patients can bleed a lot, and there is increased incidence of facial nerve stimulation because these bones are kind of abnormal, and so there's increased conduction of current through this bone into the facial nerve. So that can be a possible complication. So now moving on to role of pre-op imaging in guiding the surgical access and approach. So let's take a quick look at the surgical procedure. The first step is a mastoidectomy. Then the surgeon exposes the facial recess, which is the space between the facial nerve, descending facial nerve, and the chorda tympani, and superiorly the incus. They open the facial recess. Then they identify the oval the round window. And this is the round window membrane. And if they want to do a cochleostomy, a separate opening, then they go anterior to the round window, but both approaches are acceptable. But this is the more commonly accepted approach, is inserting the electrode through the round window. And there's an opening in the round window membrane, and the electrode is inserted over a stylet. And this is the view of the electrode in an opened cochlea. So this is what you see on normal post-op imaging, and on both axial and coronal images, there are certain important areas that are going to be important to the surgeon while they're doing surgery. And you can see on these images what those are. First of all, you know, they want to make sure that the sigmoid sinus is in normal position. The mastoid level of pneumatization has a significant effect on how much time the surgery is going to take. So if the mastoid is sclerotic, then they'll take a longer time to drill through the mastoid to get to the facial recess. The third area would be the facial nerve. They would want to know if the facial nerve is in normal position or it's aberrant. Fourth area is the round window. They'd want to know if there's any round window stenosis beforehand. Fifth area would be the tegmen. They would want to know if there's a low-lying tegmen, because that's going to modify their approach a little bit. So these are all things we should be looking for on our pre-op imaging and warn the surgeon if any of these are not as they should be. This is a patient who has severely sclerotic mastoid and a big emissary vein. And obviously, these are important findings that the surgeon would want to know and would consider before they do surgery. This is a patient who has a sclerotic mastoid. In addition to that, has a low-lying tegmen, actually had a dehiscent facial nerve in its posterior tympanic segment, and has a very anterior and lateral sigmoid sinus. And these are all important findings that we can tell the surgeon pre-operatively and warn them that they might be running into some complications because of that. This is a patient who has bilateral symptoms, but if you look on the CT, the cochlear aperture on the right side is open, whereas on the left side, we're not that sure. We get an MRI, and sure enough, there is absent cochlear nerve on the left side, so the right side is going to be the side that's implanted, so this is side selection. Now, on the right side, there are a few other things that are going on which are important to note. First of all, the round window is stenotic, important for the surgeon. Second of all, there is this sort of tubular structure which is going from the IOC directly onto the cochlear promontory. And you can kind of see it also on the coronal images. And a normal facial nerve was never seen on this patient. So this was an aberrant facial nerve which was sitting right on top of the surgical field on top of the cochlear promontory. And was something that, the surgeon really was happy that we were able to tell him that there might be, an aberrant facial nerve in his surgical path. This is the contralateral side on the same patient. You can see there is a duplicated mastoid segment of the facial nerve and an overhanging or prolapsed tympanic segment of the facial nerve. This is a patient who has a high-riding jugular bulb. And this is very important because if this is where the surgeon is going to be inserting their cochlear implant, so if they know beforehand that this is present, so they will make their cochleostomy more anterior. This is a patient who had hearing loss from meningitis, and on these heavily T2-weighted image sequences, you can see that the cochlea looks like it's got nice fluid signal. The vestibule, not so much. Bilateral vestibular, fibrous replacement of the fluid. And this patient also had a CT which did not show labyrinthitis ossificans. However, on this one image, at the level of the round window, you could actually see that there was some soft tissue. So the surgeon went in, and this turned out to be scar tissue, and they had a very hard time getting their cochlear implant electrode through this area. Intraoperatively, they had to modify their approach and actually go a little bit more anterior to the round window from a separate cochleostomy, as illustrated in this image. This is a patient who has bilateral hearing loss, and which side are they going to do implant on? Well, the left IOC is bigger, so that's a good sign. And the left cochlear aperture is bigger, and the right cochlear aperture is stenotic. We get an MRI, and the MRI confirms that there is a cochlear nerve present on the left, absent on the right. So the site of surgery is chosen to be the left side. Now, if you look more carefully, there are a few factors which are going to impact surgery. First of all, this mastoid is a rock. There's not a single air cell here. Second of all, there is this tubular structure, which is emanating from the carotid canal and traveling up along the cochlear promontory, as seen on both axial and coronal images, ultimately ending up in the obturator foramen of the stapes. So this is an incidental or coincidental persistent stapedial artery. We can't stop right there because there's a few more things. The round window is pretty stenotic. So multiple factors which could impact surgery here. Turns out the surgeon could not do a mastoidectomy here. They had to do a transcanal approach to the round window because this bone was so dense and sclerotic. And on the intraop images, you could see that the persistent stapedial artery was sitting right in the operative field, but thanks to the fact that we had warned him about it preoperatively, he was able to avoid transecting it. Again, which side do we do surgery on in this patient? So you can see that the left side has absent cochlear nerve and the right side has a cochlear nerve. So yeah, that's a pretty obvious site to go and do a cochlear implant on. The surgeon went in, and when they got in there, they said that there was unexpected round window stenosis. Now, that's something that you're not going to pick up on MRI. I haven't seen it too often. I mean, this is the region of the round window, and I don't think even in retrospect I could have called that round window stenosis. So turns out that I think both CT and MRI really complement each other, and both should be done in the pre-op setting. This patient also had other factors which made the surgery kind of complicated. There was a low-lying tegmen, and the mastoid was pretty sclerotic, so it made for a pretty pretty hairy surgical experience for our otologist. This is a patient who has bilateral cochlear nerve deficiency or absent cochlear nerves. So this is when, you know, which side are they going to choose? So here you can see that the left IAC is a little bit larger than the right. And just based on that, the surgeon thought that there might be a little bit of aberrant cochlear nerve on this side, piggybacking on the facial nerve. And so this was the site chosen for surgery. So in summary, for the factors that guide surgical access or approach, degree of pneumatization of the mastoid air cells has a big role to play in how long the surgery is going to take. Round window stenosis, presence or absence, aberrant facial nerve course, a low-lying tegmen, presence of big emissary veins or anterior or lateral located sigmoid sinus. And like I mentioned, labyrinthitis ossificans by itself is not a contraindication to surgery, but it may alter the surgical approach. Instead of doing cochlear implantation through the round window, the surgeon might prefer to go anterior to the round window through a separate cochleostomy. So the general rules for site selection can be modified to state that if the hearing loss is same in both ears, the surgeon would want to implant the site which is easier technically. So i.e., you know, if you have somebody who has labyrinthitis ossificans or malformation, cochlear malformation on one side, then the surgeon would prefer to do the opposite or contralateral side. If there is evidence for unilateral cochlear nerve deficiency, then it's obvious that the implantation should be performed on the side with the better developed cochlear nerve or better audiological findings. If there is bilateral cochlear nerve deficiency, the surgeon will still try cochlear implantation because some auditory fibers might be traveling, piggybacking along the facial nerve. So in summary, we have discussed what a cochlear implant is. We have discussed imaging findings which may impact candidacy, prognosis, and site of surgery. Most importantly, presence of cochlear anomalies, presence of a modialis, presence of a cochlear nerve, labyrinthitis ossificans. We discuss imaging findings which may impact surgical access and approach, including degree of pneumatization of the mastoid air cells, round window, facial nerve course, and low-lying tegmen. Thank you very much for your attention.
Our final lecturer in this section is Dr. Sugato Mukherjee, Associate Professor of Radiology, University of Virginia Health System, Charlottesville, Virginia. His topic today is post-surgical imaging of surgical implants, expected findings versus complications.
Hello, everyone. My name is Sugato Mukherjee from the University of Virginia Health System, and I'm going to speak on post-surgical imaging of cochlear implants, expected findings versus complications. I've got no relevant disclosures. We have two main objectives here. The first one is to be familiar with cochlear implants and their expected post-op imaging appearance. And the next part is to look at some common complications of cochlear implant placements, both on x-rays and cross-sectional imaging. Let's start with the basics here. As we all know, a cochlear implant is a surgically placed device which converts the sound to an electrical signal and which we then transmit via electrodes to the spiral ganglion cells. Now, as you all know, they have got both external and internal components. In the post-op setting, for the most part, we are asked to look at electrodes, and that's where we will put most of attention in this presentation. So the outline of this presentation is kind of based on these three things. We would like to know what is the pre-surgical indication, imaging, surgical approach, and op notes if available. You do want to know or have an idea about the different kind of implants, more specifically the electrodes itself, and we should know what is being asked for the current imaging, what exactly the patient is complaining of. So the first thing that you want to know is why actually did the patient get the initial cochlear implant? If you have got access to surgical and post-op notes, that could be helpful. And finally, if you have got access to the pre-op imaging, that could also be very helpful. So let me show you an example here. So this is a patient who came with a cochlear implant placed outside. And when you look at the images, you can see that this is the cochleostomy site, and you can see the electrodes going in the basal turn of the cochlea. Then on the middle image, you can see that they actually extend out of the cochlea through the cochlear aperture. And finally, you can see that they are coiled within the internal auditory canal. Now, when you look carefully, you can see that the cochlear aperture looks a little bit abnormal here. When you review the pre-op images on this patient, you can see that the patient has this abnormality on both the sides, which includes not only an abnormally widened cochlear aperture, you can see the modalis looks a little bit off, and the apex is also doesn't look normal. So he has got a cochlear abnormality along with this wide aperture and very poorly visualized modalis. So this is a case of an X-linked Gusher syndrome. And these patients are prone to complications during cochlear implantation, not only with the implant getting outside of the cochlea, but also these are prone to CSF leaks, meningitis, and so on. The next part of the slide will quickly go over some cochlear implants and especially the electrodes, and having a little bit of a background in it will make your job easier when you evaluate these implants. So this is an x-ray, a post-implant x-ray, and when you look at this, you can see that the patient has 22 electrodes here. This is the superior and the lateral semicircular canal, and this is kind of the cochleostomy site, and you can see the patient has maybe three or four electrodes outside. And unless and until you know that what kind of an electrode it is or what kind of an implant it is very easy to call this clearly abnormal and say, you know, four or three electrodes are outside the cochleostomy site. However, as I will show you, there are different implants where some number of electrodes can be outside the cochlea, and that is how they work. So it's important to know the number of electrodes and the kind of cochlear implant to make an accurate call. This was an abnormal case as the patient had a nucleus kind of a cochlear implant with three electrodes outside the cochleostomy site. And this is not very complicated. There are three basic systems which are approved, FDA approved here in US. One of which is the Nucleus from the Cochlear Corporation, the MedEL from the Medical Electronics, and Clarion from Advanced Bionics. They all have different models with multi-channel stimulation, multiple contacts, and they're all inserted into the scalar tympani. Now, when you look at these electrodes, you know, and the implants, they are all very different, right? They can have different models. So, for example, they differ in their rigidity and the length, the number of electrodes. So this is an example of a cochlear one where you can have two extra cochlear electrodes as a normal part of the placement itself. Also, there is they can be placed in a perimodular versus lateral wall versus mid-scalar location. And it's good to know the exact build of these electrodes. This is another slide which kind of goes in detail and shows some pictures of these different electrodes. But again, the main thing for us is to know the number of electrodes and whether they are all should be cochlear or extra cochlear. The other thing which you can see about in these implants is whether they are perimodular versus lateral wall. Again, from the imaging perspective, it is hard to distinguish, but the difference here is both of them are within the scalar tympani. The lateral wall are along the lateral or the outer aspect. The medial or the perimodular ones are next to the spiral ganglion. And there are a couple of differences here. You know, the lateral walls, they allow for larger spread of excitation. They cause less damage to the spiral ganglion cells. The perimodular ones, on the other hand, are probably a little bit more precise, but they're also more prone to trauma. And as I just talked about on the previous slide, it is very hard to distinguish between these two on imaging. What I mean is distinguishing between lateral wall or perimodular. Now in this image, which I got from online, the same patient has got a perimodular and a lateral wall electrode. And here you can see that, you know, the kind of the circle formed by the perimodular one is a little bit smaller than the one which is lateral wall. But these things are very, very hard to call on imaging. And I don't think your surgeon would, at least in this current state, would request you to differentiate between those two. Now, this is an important slide. I want you to pay attention to this, SAM-MI. So here we are going to talk about scalar tympani. So all of these electrodes are inserted into the scalar tympani. And the reason for that is when you put them in the scalar tympani, they are much closer to the inner hair, the spiral ganglion, the hair cells, and the organ of Corti. So you get much better results. Scalar vestibuli is further away from this one. And of course, if the electrode goes into the scalar media, you know, that's probably going to cause a lot of trauma and result in loss of whatever residual hearing is there. So important image, all electrodes are inserted into the scalar tympani. This is a photomicrograph and kind of a high-resolution CT images, which shows that, you know, this is the apex and this is the base of the cochlea, the basilar turn, and you can estimate where the scalar vestibuli and the scalar tympani are going to be based on their orientation as compared to the apex versus the base of the cochlea. And here you can see when the electrode is kind of along the basilar aspect, it's probably in the scalar tympani. This is from a very nice article by Verbist, published in ASHNR a few years ago. So the last part of trying to figure this one out is to know what is the current indication for the study. So the most common complications are those related to infections. They go all the way from superficial to deep, you know, skin flap, abscesses, mastoiditis, meningitis, labyrinthitis. Truth be told, for most of these, the clinicians are not going to ask you or get an imaging for the most part. Now, device issues can be both due to secondary to migration as well as failure, kinking, breakage, and then you can have those rarer symptoms of vestibular or sometimes even facial nerve symptoms. And when you look at post-procedure imaging, they come in kind of two separate settings. So one is the intra-op or the immediate post-op, where the imaging technique would be x-rays, cone beam, CT, or even none. For example, in our institution, we don't do any intra-op, and in many cases, not even an immediate post-op imaging, if the clinicians feel that, you know, the insertion went well. But when you do get an imaging done, the issues are mainly those to confirm the intracochlear positioning and the integrity of the electrode array and detection for electrode kinking. Whereas when it's remotely done, it could be both x-rays as well as other cross-sectional studies. And the issues here are device failure and some unusual complications such as those of tinnitus. So, well, what does the clinician wants to know? Of course, the clinician wants to know the insertion depth, the shape of the electrodes, the morphology, etc. This is another important slide. I want to point your attention again to SAM-MI. So the view which is most commonly done in the post setting on x-rays is what is known as a modified Stenver's view. And it's an oblique view, 45 degrees posteriorly, 12 degrees chordally, because it shows the entire kind of the petrous bone and the IAC and the bony labyrinth in a much better detail. So this image is a close-up of this one. And here you can see that we can visualize the entire cochlear electrode, right? We can see the internal auditory canal. We can see the superior and the lateral semicircular canals. And you can see the electrode coming in and going into the entire cochlea, kind of more than 270 degrees of coiling within the cochlea itself. So this is why this view is done, modified Stenver's view. That is presumably the yellow line corresponds to the cochleostomy site. Now look at some x-ray images. So I got these graphics from the article by Nash from 2020. In these graphics, you can see the cochlear electrode is colored as orange and the cochleostomy site is in blue, and an x-ray shows a normal appearance of the electrode coiling approximately 270 degrees within the cochlea itself. So when we look at these, it's also important to measure and talk about, as we alluded to in one of the previous slides, about the number of electrodes within and outside the cochlea too, when you can. Here's an example of a complication where you can see on the graphic that the tip has folded over. And on this one image, you can see how, although the cochlea goes all the way in towards the end, it kind of folds on itself. And this is something which the surgeon kind of suspects when they are inserting the cochlear electrode itself. So this is, in many cases, an intra-op or an immediate post-op kind of a picture. And they will feel a lot of resistance towards the end of the procedure itself. On a similar vein, you can see a really bad case of kind of an electrode kinking. In this case, you know, you can see that the electrodes are barely within kind of, less than half of a circle insertion, and then they fold on itself and they are very severely kinked. Again, these are not very hard to identify, and for the most part, the surgeon almost suspects and knows about this right when he's putting these electrodes. This one is an under insertion, and again, it's quite clear on this one that, you know, you expect the array to kind of go for almost 370 degrees out here. This is not a very good modified Stenver's view. It's quite clear from the image itself. So this is a case of an electrode insertion. You would want the tip to kind of extend all the way till up till here, depending on the kind of the electrode itself. On a CT, this is how a normal post-op would look. So you can see the electrode is kind of starting right at the cochleostomy site, kind of going into the basilar turn of the cochlea and coiling within the cochlea almost for 3/4 of the circle itself. So what are some of the complications you can see on CT? Well, we can see incomplete insertions, depending on whether the electrode tip gets stuck in the mastoids, the middle ear, or the cochleostomy site. They could have fractures and kinks. And finally, they could be aberrant insertions pretty much anywhere from vestibule to semicircular canals to aqueducts, carotid canals, and so on and so forth. In some of these cases, the patients might be asymptomatic and the device just doesn't work. And in some of these cases, not only the device would not be working, but they would also have additional symptoms. So there are two examples of incomplete insertions. In this case, you can see that the electrode basically is coiled in the mastoid and the tip is just medial to the cochleostomy site. There is no electrode visible in the basal turn of the cochlea. In this image, you can see that the electrode actually does not even go beyond the mastoid itself. And in this case, the surgeon could not insert it within the cochlea. And you can see the reason why. It looks like there's a lot of hyperdense components within the basilar turn of the cochlea. So this was a case of labyrinthitis ossificans. And in really severe cases, you know, it would be very hard for the surgeon to actually get into the cochlea too. Here you can see, instead of the basilar turn of the cochlea, the electrode is actually just outside of that and lateral and deep to that in the OT capsule. I also want to point your attention to this part here where it seems like there is a discontinuity within the electrode itself. You can probably make it out a little bit here too. So it might be that there is a fracture in this electrode too. And, you know, these three images show the tip of the electrode within the vestibule. So these patients might have tinnitus-like symptoms. This one is in the superior semicircular canal. This one is in the carotid canal. Now, if they are very close to the facial nerve near the geniculate, the patients can have some unusual facial nerve symptoms. I want to end by talking a couple of additional things here. So the first one is to figure out, can we differentiate between insertions within the scalar tympani versus scalar vestibule, and then talk a little bit about standardized reporting. So as we talked about, right, the electrodes are placed within the scalar tympani, right? So when you look at this graphic, you can see that for every turn, you have got the scalar vestibuli towards the apical part of the cochlea, and we have the scalar tympani towards the basilar part of the cochlea, right? So apex, base. This is the basal turn, and here you can see that this electrode is along kind of the outer slash basilar part of the basilar turn, right? So this is correlates with the placement of the electrode within the scalar tympani. Now, this has, you know, these images are from Fisher's article in ASHNR in 2015. To show you another image, here you can see the electrode, instead of being along the basilar side, again, this is the apex, this is the basilar turn of the cochlea. So the electrode, instead of being on the basilar part like in this one, it's more along the apical part of the basilar turn, if it makes sense. So this is a case of electrode within the scalar vestibule rather than the scalar tympani. So this is something which we might get asked to do more often in the near future, although in our institution, our surgeons don't ask us to do that. I'm not going to get into too much of detail on this part, but I would rather refer to you to the article by Dr. Hudgens regarding standardization of CT depiction of cochlear implant insertion depth. This is a table I kind of straight away grabbed from her article. And if you go back and look at how we dictate reports, you will see that a lot of times we kind of do it in a very non-specific way, which is not very helpful to the clinicians, and we probably have a lot of scope for improvement. I'm probably getting towards the end of my time, so I'm not going to talk about this in too much of detail, but these slides would be available in your handout. But basically, you can use a system like this, do an oblique reformat, and you can talk about where the cochlear tip is, which is in the region 4 in this one. And these kind of standardized reporting probably would help your surgeon a lot more than some of the terms which we currently use in our reporting. If you're interested in this one, you know, I would highly urge you to read this first article, which is where it's taken from. And many of the things I talked about are also covered in these additional articles. If you have any questions or comments, please get back to me at my email address. Thank you so much.